this morning what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be wrapping up our Overcome series. We've been speaking about being an overcomer. Our theme this year is that we are overcomers in Christ Jesus and that we can overcome. And we've foundational scripture for this whole series and for our, this year is found in 1 John chapter 5. It says, "For everyone born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith." You are an overcomer because God says so in His Word. Come on, let's pray. God, I thank You that as we go into Your Word this morning, I thank You that Your Word has power, that Your Word has the ability just to take us from where we are to the place where You've called us to be. God, I thank You that Your Word just reveals hope and just illuminates the path that we're traveling so that we can follow You in the way that You're going. God, I thank You, Lord, that as we receive Your Word today, it would take root in our heart. It would accomplish all that You've set it out to do. In Jesus' name, amen. And so this morning, I've titled my message, Going the Distance. Going the Distance. If we're going to overcome in our life, we have to go the distance. In order to succeed in life, you can't quit halfway. We got to go the distance, and when we go the distance, we overcome in life. Amen. I don't know if any of you know somebody, or maybe in your own personal life, you've been in a position where you know that you've been on the right path and you've been doing the right thing, and you've been pursuing and following God, but with all of the maybe the challenges or adversity or the persecution or whatever it may be, the difficulties of just keep pursuing, you've kind of stopped short, and in knowing that you've stopped short, that you've missed out on a blessing or the breakthrough that God has for your life. And I believe God has called us as individuals, as Christ followers, to go the distance. To go when we don't feel like it, when it doesn't seem like things are changing in our life. But we've been called to not quit, to not stop, but to keep on going, holding on to the faith that God has deposited in our hearts so that we can overcome. You know, Jacob's story in Bible, in Genesis, talks about Jacob. How Jacob, we wrestled with God. Jacob was on the run. He wasn't able to get the breakthrough. And then he had a visitation from the angel of the Lord. And when the angel of the Lord came in and visited him, he never let go of the angel. The Bible says that he wrestled the night. He wrestled the night with the angel of the Lord. And because he did, he found favor and had victory with God. And God blessed him. I want to say that we get the blessing of God on our life. The blessing of God is available for every single one of us. But the blessing comes when we go the distance and we don't stop short and don't fall short of what God has for us. We've got to go the distance for any relationship, any business, any church. To succeed in life, there needs to be a wholehearted commitment that says, I'm going to go the distance. Turn to your neighbor and say to them, go the distance. Go the distance. And there's no better example for us to look at than the life of Jesus. Jesus, in Hebrews chapter 12, speaking about Jesus, it says that for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Because Jesus endured and he never gave up and he went the distance, right now he's seated at the right hand of God. And look what it says, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners. That means that we need to look to him, we need to see how he did it, because he faced a whole lot of hostility in his life, but yet he went the distance. And look what it says, he endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Don't grow weary and lose heart. You got to keep going the distance. You got to keep believing that the promise of God is for your life. And there's no greater person to be than a follower of Christ, knowing that because Jesus, listen, we serve a high priest. We serve a God who is like no other God. The Bible says in Hebrews 4 is that we have a high priest who can empathize with us. There's a difference between sympathy and empathy. Sympathy is, I'm feeling for you because of something that's happened to you. Empathy is, I feel for you because I've been through what you've been through. And it says that we have a high priest who has been through everything that you and I have been through. He's faced the temptation. He's faced the hardships of life, but he endured. And so we come to him right now, and we don't come to him discussing our life with him like thinking, well, he's never been through it. No, he's been through everything that you and I have been through, and we can endure because he has endured. And so this morning, I want to just talk about a few things before I get into the bulk of our message about why we can go the distance. Did you know that you can go the distance today? Despite what you're facing, despite what you're experiencing, despite the season you find yourself in, you can go the distance. The first reason is this, is because God's hand is on your life. You know, when God's hand's on your life, You can go the distance. It doesn't matter what comes against you when God's hand's on your life. When God's hand's on your life, it means that God is for you. And if God is for you, it doesn't matter what comes against you. When God's hand's on your life, you start to experience life and you start to think differently about life. We've got to believe that God's hand is on our life. Do you believe God's hand is on your life? Never doubt that God's hand's on your life just because of what you're facing right now. Just because of what you're going through in the season of your life. Maybe there's a hardship, maybe there's a difficult, maybe there's something you're struggling with in your life. The enemy wants you to think that because you're going through a season that may not be a season of blessing, may not be a season where you're experiencing the full picture of what God has for your life. Just because you're going through that season doesn't mean God's hand's not on your life. God's hand was more on Jesus when he was going through the wilderness than any other time, because as he came through that period, it says he came out with power and might. God's hand's on your life. And when God's hand's on your life, no one can stop you. It's amazing when you realize God's hand's on your life, what favor and blessing you start to walk in. God's hand is on your life. Look what it says here in Scripture. It says in Isaiah 41 verses 10, "For I am your God, and I will strengthen you and help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Yeah, the Scripture says that because God's hand's on your life, it says, number one, that God's going to strengthen you. God's going to strengthen you to do what he's called you to do. And not only is he going to strengthen you, he's going to help you. And I really believe that many of us, we have the strength to go, but sometimes we don't know the direction or what the next step would be. Well, I believe that scripture is saying is that when we find ourselves in that situation, we have a God who doesn't only strengthen us, but he helps us in the time where we have need. The third thing it says is that he upholds us. That when the enemy tries to bring us down or bring things against us, or maybe we stumble, it says there that the righteous right hand of the Lord upholds us. It's speaking about the right hand of God. The right hand of God speaks about power. It speaks about authority. It speaks about rulership. And God says, I've put that hand on your life. And when that hand is on your life, you can walk in confidence. You can walk in boldness. God's hand is on your life. You need to know this morning, it doesn't matter what your life looks like, God's hand is on your life. His hand is on his church. His hand is on this nation. We got to believe as a church that he hasn't removed his hand on this nation. God's hand is on you. When you believe God's hand's on you, you can endure and go the distance. The second reason we can go the distance is because we realize that we in Christ Jesus are more than conquerors. You see, Jesus came and he conquered. He conquered death and the grave. And because he conquered the death and the grave, we become more than conquerors. You see, a conqueror is somebody who goes into battle or goes into a situation and comes out victorious. But the Bible says that we are not just victorious, we are more than conquerors. That means we get the spoil and the blessing of the battle as well. When you go into a battle, God doesn't expect you and doesn't want you to come out less blessed than when you went in. I want to encourage us this morning that you are more than a conqueror. The third reason that we can go the distance is because God's favor is on your life. God's favor is on your life. You know, it's amazing when you start believing God's favor is on your life. When you start actually speaking God's favor over your life, when you start to speak God's favor over your life, you start to get blessing like you've never had before. You start to see doors of opportunities that open up in your life. You see, often in our life, what happens is we go through maybe a season of difficulty or maybe we look at all the negative things that are happening around us and we never let the negativity outcloud or blur the vision of God's favor on our life. Because God's favor is on our life. In Christ Jesus, we are favored, we are called, and we are blessed by God. Never underestimate the favor of God. Look what it says in Psalm 30 verses 5. For his anger lasts only a moment. There's some people they need to know this morning. God's not angry with you. God's not angry with you. His anger lasts only for a moment, and he took his anger out on Jesus on the cross so that you and I could experience the life. It says only lasts a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may last through the night, but joy comes with the morning. You know what it's saying there? Is that there are different seasons. There's different things that we face in our life, and sometimes we go through a difficult season, and it feels like night, and it feels like hard, and it feels difficult, but in the morning comes joy. It's talking about God's favor in the morning. When you wake up, I want to encourage you, if you're in the workplace, in the market, if you've got your own business, if you're a salesperson, if you're a teacher, whatever you're doing for the glory of God, speak God's favor over your life. Speak God's favor over your business. Speak to the things. Listen, when you speak God's favor, you're concurring with God. Because God's declared a blessing over your life. Speak the favor of God. You know, when the church used to get together, Israel used to get together, what they would do is they would have a meeting like we're having this morning, and after the meeting, Aaron the priest would come, and then they would speak a blessing over the people. And when they would pray this blessing, things would change in their life. Look what it says here. It says they would pray this prayer over the children of Israel in Numbers chapter 6. It says, may the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Look what it says in verses 27. It says, whenever Aaron and his sons bless the people of Israel in my name, I myself will bless them. So God's saying there that whenever we declare his favor over our lives and we stand in agreement with his word over our life, God says now, not that you just because you've said it, but because of my word and I honor my word, I'm going to bless you with that favor. God's favor is on your life. You didn't realize God's favor is on your life. You don't live in fear. You don't live in anxiety. You have the boldness to step out in faith and believe him for the impossible. Amen. The fourth thing is this, is that why can we go the distance? I really love this one. It's because heaven is behind us. Heaven is behind us. There are people in heaven that have walked this journey, walked this earth, just like you and I, walking out their faith in a practical way every single day and faced persecution, faced hardship and difficulty. And they're in heaven right now. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 that they were surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses cheering us on. There's more people cheering you on right now than people that are against you. And we can go the distance because heaven is behind us. And when heaven is behind us, we can go the distance. Number five, I really believe we go the distance when we make a decision. When we decide to go the distance. It's amazing. It's amazing what we can accomplish when we make a decision in our life. When you make a decision to get healthy, when you make a decision to get out of debt, when you make a decision to walk closely to God, it's amazing what you can accomplish when you make a decision. And when you make that decision, God moves upon that decision. Amen. We go the difference. You see, we accomplish so much in life when we make a decision to pursue God. You know what the reality is that when we make a decision to go the distance, what God does is he opens up so many doors of opportunity and we have so many different experiences. I look at the life of Paul, one of the greatest apostles. It says that when he decided to follow Jesus, his whole life changed. He went from being the persecutor of the church, somebody who was trying to destroy the work of God. He made a decision that I'm going to follow Christ. And when he did that, he had the whole body of believers, the whole church behind him, praying for him, urging him on. He had blessing, he had hospitality. He had all the blessing that came with making a decision. But with that decision, he also faced some hardships and difficulties. And in those hardships and difficulties, people came up against him. The enemy tried to destroy him. There's hardships. And we have to have the inward ability to make a decision that it doesn't matter what comes up against me. It doesn't matter what people say about me. I'm going the distance for God. I'm going to stick to the course. I'm going to run the race that God's called me to run. Keep going the distance. Why? Because when we go the distance, we receive the reward that God has for our life. Amen. You never know. Listen, you never know what doors of opportunity God can open when you go the distance. I believe there's people in this building right now that God's preparing your future. He's already prepared doors and people across your path that are going to take you to the purpose that he's called you to. But the key is this, is that you've got to go the distance. You've got to go, never stop short. Never go stop short of serving God. Why? Because when you keep serving him, you keep planted in his house, you keep following him, you receive the reward that he has for your life in Jesus' name. It takes a lot of commitment. It takes a lot of commitment. It takes a decision, a determination, focus, prayer to say that I'm going to overcome. And sometimes in our life, the hardest decision is the decision to stay in something. It takes sometimes more faith to stay in something than to step out into something new. It takes more faith to believe God that he can heal your marriage rather than looking for a new one. It takes faith to believe that you're going to get through whatever you're facing right now. And so I want to encourage us, let's go the distance in our life. You know, I've written here in my notes is that the regret of stopping short is greater than the pain of overcoming. You know, the truth is sometimes it's hard and it's difficult and we've got to push through and sometimes we get weary and we get tired. But I want to tell you now that the pain of stopping, the regret of stopping is nothing in comparison to the reward that awaits you if you keep pushing through. Got to keep pushing through. Keep going the distance in your relationship. You know, my daughters, I love my daughters and, you know, I believe God's hand's on their life and you know, they're just doing life. We're trying to raise them up in a godly way, in a godly manner. And you know, my daughter Hannah, she loves music, and she started piano lessons. When she started piano lessons in the beginning, it was like she just wanted to play like the professionals without doing the learning. And so what happened was, we would say to her, Hannah, you gotta just take it one step at a time, and sometimes she would be practicing it, and in her practicing, knowing what the song should sound like and what it does sound like when she plays it, it was frustrating. And so often she would get up and say, well, you know what, this is frustrating. But you know what, she had such a willingness and a determination to keep going and to keep going. And then this week, I was invited to her school to watch a music assembly. And there she was, playing the songs on the piano in front of the whole school. And I thought to myself, the fulfillment in that moment outweighs the frustration of trying to get there. I want to encourage you, don't let the frustration of the moment steal the fulfillment that God has for your life. God can do great things in your life when you keep going the distance. And so keep going the distance. 2 Timothy 4, verses 7, Paul says to Timothy, he says this, I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race and I've kept the faith. You see, Paul's speaking to Timothy and he's reflecting on his life. Paul is in his mid-60s getting ready to go to be with the Lord. And so he calls Timothy in and he says, Timothy, I've looked at my life and I've reflected over my life. And I realized there's three things that I've done in my life. He says, I've fought the good fight, I've run the race, and I've kept the faith. And Paul is living the full life. He's looked at his life and he said, you know what, Timothy, I've lived the full life. I want to tell you right now, when we follow Jesus, God calls us to live a full life. Not a life that has no meaning. You see, a full life is a life that is effective, a life that has purpose, a life that has influence and significance. And I want to encourage us that God has called us to live a full life. And that same life that Paul lived, pursuing Jesus, following God, establishing the kingdom, Paul went throughout Europe and Asia. And while he was out in Europe and Asia, he established the church. And that's exactly what God has called you and I to do. You see, we find our greatest fulfillment in the purposes of God. In actual fact, your purpose is linked to the things of God. Building God's house, building God's kingdom, establishing the church on this earth. And so Paul, he starts reflecting and he's talking to Timothy and he says that my life has been full and my life has been effective. And you know, the effectiveness of your life is not revealed by the quantity of your life or the quality of your life. The effectiveness of your life is measured by how many people you touch for the kingdom of God. And Paul says to Timothy, I've run the race. I fought the good fight. And so the first thing that he says is that I've fought the good fight. And I want to say this right now as a follower of Christ, we're in a fight. We're in a fight. If you don't believe me, you can just look at your children, how the enemy is trying to steal their souls and their salvation. We're in a fight and God's called us to fight the good fight of faith. And you know, when you talk about a fight in the south of Joburg, everybody comes alive. Now I've got friends in this building that you talk about a fight, they can tell you every move. You go to the north, you talk about a fight, they don't know what you're talking about. I want to encourage us that we're in a fight. The Bible says it's a good fight. It's a good fight. You see, we're not fighting against people. We're fighting for people. We're not fighting against each other. We're fighting for each other. When we start fighting for the right things, we start fighting for what matters the most, we start to see the blessing of God unfold. We start to see the hand of God move. Listen, I want to encourage us, don't fight those that God has called to be alongside you. We fight for people, amen, not with people. Come on, am I helping you this morning? Just keep looking at your spouse and saying, man, baby, I told you, I'm fighting for you, man. Don't get caught up in the wrong fight. It's so easy for us to get caught up in the wrong fight. And Paul says to Timothy, the fight that we're fighting is a fight of faith. It's a fight that we're called to win, and it's a good fight. Because let me tell you, the only good fight is the fight you win. It's never been, I don't know if you've ever been in a fight here, but being in a fight and losing is not a good fight. The reason we win the fight and it's a good fight is because when we hold on to our faith, in the end, we win. So we've won the fight, but I want to say that just because we win the fight, it doesn't mean that we're not in the fight. We call to fight. We call to fight for the souls of people in our life. We call to fight for justice. We call to fight for the things that are dear to God's heart. God is a warrior. The Bible says in Exodus chapter 15, it says that the Lord is a warrior. Warrior is His name. God is a warrior. You might say to me, well, you know, as a Christian, I'm not called to fight. I'm called to love. I want to tell you, you're called to fight and your weapon is love. Your weapon is love. Because if you don't fight for people, who's going to fight for them? There's just something about people who have a fighting spirit. And I'm not talking about a contentious spirit. I'm talking about a spirit that says, we're not going to give up. We're going to go the distance. That even if we fall and even if we stumble, we're going to rise up again. I love the fact that every morning we get the opportunity to wake up with a new, fresh sense of vision, sense of purpose, fighting for the lost of south of Johannesburg, fighting for the lost in our nation, fighting for the lost in our world. We're fighting for salvation for people's lives in Jesus' name. I love what Timothy says. Paul says to Timothy, he says, endure suffering along with me. So Paul says, listen, when you fight the good fight of faith, there are going to be some seasons when you go through where you're going to get the victory and you're going to rejoice and celebrate. But there's also going to be some times where you're going to have to endure and you're going to have to go through. There are going to be disappointments. There might be a difficulty, but he says, endure with me. He speaks, saying to him, you know, have a resilience on the inside of you. Have a grit on the inside of you. Have a determination that just because something doesn't work out, you're not going to quit. You're going to keep going the distance because you have a spirit of somebody who endures. And look what he says, as a good soldier of Christ Jesus, soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life. For then they cannot please the officer who enlisted them. Paul is saying to Timothy is that one of the functions of a believer is that we're soldiers. We're soldiers of God. We're in the army of God. And what do armies do? What does the army do? The army protects the nation. But not only does the army protect a nation, the army goes out into battle to gain territory and find new ground. And that's exactly what God's called us to do as a church, as believers, as a body of Christ, globally and locally. We're called to go into the world and take territory. Go into battle and fight the enemy and fight for the souls of people and take territory for the kingdom of God. You know, there's something that happens in people's lives when one man stands up. You just need one person in a family. You just need one person in a business. You just need one person in a church. One person in a nation who says, we're going to stand up and we're going to fight for what's right. Amazing. I don't know if any of you watched the movie Braveheart. Mel Gibson. It's amazing. He painted his face in those funny colors. And a whole nation got behind him. Why? Because when one person, when one woman, when one youth, when one student, when one person at work, when one person at university says we're going to stand up for Jesus, you know what starts to happen? Is that people who want to stand up or too scared to suddenly stand up and start to rise. I want to tell you today, we are called to fight the good fight. Fight the good fight. The second thing that we're called to do is, Paul says to him, is that we're called to run the race. We're all in a race. When you came into a relationship with Jesus, Jesus put you in a race. And you enlisted into a race. And now we go from a soldier to an athlete. We're called to run the race that God has set before us. And when we run that race, God strengthens us. Paul said, I've finished my race. I fulfilled my purpose. I just want to say this, is that our race is all the same. Your race is exactly the same as my race. But our lanes are different. See, I'm called to the ministry lane, as in pastoring. You're called maybe to a business lane, or maybe wherever you are, a nurse, a teacher. God's put you in a lane. But our purpose is the same. And that's to take territory for the kingdom of God. And so what happens in our life is that often we look at somebody else's lane and we wish that we were running in that lane. And so in order to finish your race strong, number one, you said you've got to have a focus. You've got to be focused. Paul said this, don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs. So run to win. So look what he says. So I run with purpose in every step. You see, like I say, in athletics, when you run a race, especially on track, when there's a track, there's designated lanes. And the key is to run your race in your lane. The minute you jump out of your lane, you get disqualified. And the minute you start running in someone else's lane, you lose the reward, because the reward is always in your lane. God's reward for your life is found in the lane that He's called you to run in. And I want to encourage us that it's so easy to look at someone else's life, so easy to look at someone else's business, so easy to look at someone else's family and say, well, if I had that life, I would kind of live that life. But I want to tell you, the lane that God's put you in, He has everything He needs for your life. Marlon, why don't you come up here? I want to just show you this in a practical way. You see, because God has created each and every one of us with unique gifts and unique talents. And they're designated to build the kingdom of God. And so Marlon is a phenomenal worship leader. Come on, he's got an amazing voice. I mean, we love the fact that he can sing the little, I mean, his singing is just as good as mine. He's amazing. Father, forgive me. Anyway. But Marlon is called to run in that lane. And God knows exactly what Marlon needs in his lane. And God knows exactly what you need in your lane. And so God says, this is your lane, Marlon. And so Marlon has certain things that he requires, which God is fully aware of. Let me say this morning, God is fully aware of what you need to finish your race. And everything you need to finish your race is found in your lane, not in my lane. And so Marlon might have a different sense of endurance, a different sense of faith to what I have. And he's at a different place to where I'm at. And so in his lane, God has already positioned people to strengthen him. He's already positioned provision so that he can go on. And so God knows that Marlon can go a lot further than I can without needing strength. Come on, this is true now. Okay, so Marlon's strength is halfway down the track. And so Marlon is running, and he's running his race. And as he starts getting weary, God sends somebody in that moment to strengthen him. Because he's in his lane. And God, he needs provision to go to the next level. And as he gets to that place of provision, God gives it to him to go to that next level so that he can go the distance. Now the challenge is that I'm different to Marlon. And so my stamina and my strength may not be the same as him. And I may need support right at the starting line. And so I decide, I'm going to be Marlon. Sing it again. No. Okay. So. Sounds like that. No, I'm joking. So I'm looking for strength and I've started and I'm starting to run and I'm giving God, Lord, I'm giving you everything I can. But the strength is not here. In Marlon's lane, the strength is there. And so I'm running and I'm get to the point where I need strength and I can't go the distance anymore because I'm not running in my lane. And I'm going to collapse before I get to the point where there's strength. But when I get into my lane, which is this lane, God says, I'm going to put somebody there. Somebody's going to be there. Breakthrough's going to be there. Provision's going to be there. So stick to your lane. Stick to the lane that God's called you to be. Thank you, Marlon. We love your singing. Stay focused. I want to say this, is that God wants you to stay focused. And the enemy knows that there's power in focus. So what happens at times is that there's opportunity. We call them opportunity, but sometimes they're distractions. You see, there are opportunities that we think, well, you know, there's a new job, or there's a transfer, or there's a new partner, or there's something new that's come up. And we say, like, it's a God opportunity. But sometimes they're a distraction. Because any opportunity that brings you away from the purposes of God is a distraction. And not just because there's more money in the new job means it's God's will for your life. Not just because there's an opportunity to go overseas or find a new transfer. It doesn't mean that it's of God. And I'm not saying it's not of God. What I'm saying is that you've got to seek godly counsel. Like God gives you a pastor in leadership so that you can speak about these things. It went quiet like this in the first service. The truth is that we see so many people, they're like, God's given me this opportunity. And we're like, no. Please, if anything draws you away from God, if God creates an opportunity, he provides an infrastructure and a support system, and he provides blessing and opportunity. Listen, if you're going into a new city and you believe God is calling you to a new place and there is not a local church, you've got to think twice. Because your purposes and your calling and the opportunity that God has for your life is always linked to building his church and his kingdom. Come on, give him a praise if you believe that. Stay focused. Number two, you've got to have endurance. You've got to have endurance. Where are we going to run your race? You've got to have endurance. You've got to have that willingness that says that when it gets tough, we're going to keep going. You see, endurance is the ability to push through in life when everything comes against you. It's the endurance. You know, Jesus endured in the darkest moment of his life. He endured the cross. Not because he was weak, but he made a decision that I'm not going to stop. I'm going the distance. If you're going to go the distance, you've got to have a sense of endurance on the inside of you. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not grow weary when doing well, while doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. I want to tell you right now, there's many people here. Maybe you're in a position right now and you're thinking, you know what, I don't know if I can carry on anymore. Look what the scripture says, don't lose heart, for you will reap. God's got something in your lane that's about to fill you up. And you might feel like you just want to stop right now. I want to encourage you, put your head down and say, I'm an endurer. I'm not a person who quits. I'm not a person who gives up. I'm built for this. God is a warrior. Therefore, I am strengthened by the power and the might of God. I'm going to keep going the distance. I'm going to endure hardships. I'm going to endure persecution. Because at the end of everything, there is a reward. Keep going. You've got to have a sense of enduring in your life. The third thing is, when you're running your race, you've got to have a sense of commitment. You've got to be committed. I want to encourage you right now, nothing grows without a sense of commitment. If you're not committed to your business, if you're not committed to God, if you're not committed to your church, I can tell you right now, nothing grows. It's when you have a sense of commitment, man. I'm committed to this. I'm committed to my marriage. I'm committed to building God's kingdom. It's amazing what happens when we have a sense of commitment. I love the story about Elijah and Elisha. Elijah was the prophet of God, and one day Elijah was walking past, and he came past Elisha, and Elisha was a young man plowing the ground with oxen. And what happened was, as he walked past Elijah, he took off his cloak and he threw his cloak upon him. And in that moment, Elisha got up and he made a decision, and I'm going to be committed to fulfilling the call of God on my life. And the Bible says that Elisha, the minute he got up, he took the plow and he took the oxen and he burnt it. And he, you know what he said? I'm so committed to God that I'm not looking back on my past life. I want to say this to some people this morning. I want to tell you that your life starts to change when you turn your back on what you used to be and stop reminding yourself of what you used to be. And you make a decision that today I'm turning my back and I'm committed to the future that God has for me. And he says there that he followed Elisha. He followed Elijah. For 13 years, nothing happened in his life. He was just a servant of Elijah. Just a servant, helping him. 13 years, he was committed. No promise of a blessing. No promise of a ministry. No promise of a calling. But he said, I'm committed. Something happened when Jesus touched me. And he said, I'm following God. I'm following Elijah. Elijah represented God to the nation. And look what it says, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel, which means the house of God. But Elisha said, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. So they went down to Bethel. And the company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today? Yes, I know, Elisha replied, so be quiet. Then Elijah said to him, stay here, Elisha. The Lord has sent me to Jericho. And as he replied, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. So they went to Jericho, and the company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today? Yes, I know, he replied, so be quiet. I think right now he wanted to actually just say to them, shut up, because I've heard this 3 times. Then Elijah said to him, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan. And he replied, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. So the two of them walked on. He has a man with such a great sense of commitment, such a willingness to go the distance, that even when the prophet of God said to him, stay here, he said, I won't give up. I'm going to follow God. I'm going to pursue God. When the prophets and the leadership of the church said to him, listen, you're thinking too big. You're dreaming for something that may never happen. Do you know that he's going to go today? He said, be quiet. I'm following God. I'm going the distance. He said, I want to follow my master. And our church, I want to encourage you. When you follow God and you go the distance, you get what God has. You get what God has, because if Elisha had said, you know what, you guys are right, I don't know what's going to happen, and he decided to sit down in the moment, he would have missed his moment. And the Bible says that as God took up Elijah into the heavens with the chariots of fire, is that the mantle of Elijah fell on Elisha. I want to say this, is that you can't receive the mantle if you're not in the presence. You've got to be in the presence of God to receive the blessing of God. I want to encourage us, go the distance. Be committed. Be a church builder, not a church breaker. Be a church builder, not a church critic. Be a church builder. Be the person that says, I was committed, I fought the good fight, I ran the race. When there was opposition, when there was persecution, I kept the faith. I kept going because God had a plan for my life. The last thing he says to him, he says, hold on to your faith. Hold on to your faith. He said, I hold on to my faith. I kept my faith. I want to tell you right now, the enemy is trying to steal your faith from you. He's trying to distract you. He's trying to take away what God has put on your life. I want to say right now, hold on to your faith in the midst of whatever's going on in your life right now. Your faith is your foundation. We have a God who has an unshakable kingdom. And we've got to have a faith that's unshakable. A faith that says, you know what, I'm going to stand. And having done all to stand, when the enemy comes or when hardships come and difficulties come, I'm going to be like Paul. I'm going to be focused. I'm going to fight the good fight. I'm going to run the race. And I'm going to hold on to the faith. The faith, listen, when you hold on to the faith, you are victorious. You win the good fight. Hold on to your faith. Paul said this. He said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel. For I know the one in whom I trust, and I'm sure that he's able to guard what I entrusted to him until the day of his return. God has started something in your life. God has started something in your life. And it's up to you and I to make a decision. That thing that God has started, am I going to keep going and I'm going to keep pursuing? Because he says that he who starts a good thing in your life, he will complete it. But there's a decision and there's a part that we play to say that I'm going to go the distance. Go the distance. Because beyond the pain, beyond the challenges, beyond the hardships, is a great reward. And let me say this, is that the reward is greater than the pain that you're facing right now. I want to encourage people. Maybe there's some people here, you've like, life has been too much. Fight the good fight. Allow God to strengthen you. Believe his hand is on you right now. Believe his favor is on your life. Listen to the voice of heaven cheering you. Listen to the, make a decision to say that I'm not going to quit, that I'm going to keep running, I'm going to keep going in Jesus' name. Come on, let's give him a great praise. Amen. Jesus, the Son of God, perfect in every way. God in his fullness came to earth through a man named Jesus. And his whole purpose, his whole race, was to die for humanity. That's why Jesus came. So that people could have relationship with God. And you know, church, in all honesty, sometimes church has done a disservice to the reason why Jesus came. Because we've made it about religion, we've made it about works, and we've made it about you have to get to. But Jesus says, you don't have to do anything, you just got to believe. You got to believe that I died, that I loved you so much, and that God loved you so much that he said that I would take your place on that cross. And that's why Jesus came. It's so that you and I could have relationship with God. He ran his race so that we could win the race. And this morning, the thing that God desires more from all of us, more than anything else, he doesn't want money from us, he doesn't want our skill, he doesn't want, more than any of that, he wants relationship. That's all. He's a relational God. He's a relational God. And today that relationship is freely available to every single person on this earth. But that relationship only comes through Jesus Christ. So I want to ask you just for a moment to bow your heads and close your eyes as I'm going to give an invitation to each person in this building today. I want to ask you this morning, do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? I'm not talking about knowing Jesus or knowing of Jesus, but I'm speaking about knowing Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, that he's a personal God. A personal God that you can have relationship, a personal God that you can call on in your time of need. Because Jesus came for that very reason. Now I'm going to count to three and you say, you know what, that's me. I want to have a relationship with Jesus. On the count of three, if that's you, I want to ask you to raise your hand. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way. We're not going to do that. We want to just acknowledge you. We're not going to call you out. None of that. We just want to ask you just to raise your hand where you are. One, the Bible says, for God so loved the world. He loved the world. That's you. That's me. It's everybody who doesn't know him. He loved them so much that he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross. No greater love has anybody than this, than a man, who lays down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life so that you and I could have life with God. 2, his love is an unconditional love. Your past, your history does not define who you are to God. He loves you in spite of everything that's happened in your life, and he desires relationship with you today. And his love is unconditional. 3, right now, if that's you, won't you just raise your hand, and I want to include you in that prayer. Say, you know what, I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Thank you, man. Thank you. Just raise your hands up high, wherever you are. Just keep your hands up high. Hands going up right now. You'd say, you know what, that's me. Thank you. Thank you. Maybe one more time as I look across the building. You've never made this decision in your heart to follow Jesus. Maybe you've heard things about God. You've heard things about church. And I want to tell you right now that he's a loving God. Don't let what you've heard put you off from knowing who he really is. And you'd say, you know what, that's me. I want to receive Jesus. Won't you just raise your hand one more time as I look across the building? Is there maybe one more person? Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. You can put your hands down. Maybe you used to serve God. Maybe you used to be running your race. Maybe you used to fight the good fight, but maybe things happened. Maybe you got hurt. Maybe you got upset. Maybe people said things about you. Maybe the church upset you. Maybe you got derailed, distracted, and you said, you know what, it's not worth it. It's not worth running this race. It's not worth it. And today you feel, you know what, I need to get back into the race. Today I need to get my relationship back online with God. You can make a decision today and say, God, I'm coming back home to you. I'm getting back in the race. I'm going to start fighting that good fight of faith. I'm going to start be a builder of your kingdom. Today's the day. Align your purpose with God today. The Bible says that when the prodigal son came, the father was waiting with arms wide open. If that's you today and you'd say, you know what, I want to come back home to Jesus. I want to get my life right today. I want to recommit my heart. Won't you just raise your hand right now, and I'm going to include you in that prayer. Thank you. Thank you. Just keep your hands up high. Wherever you are, there's hands going up all over. Why don't you just keep your hands up for a moment? If you're raising your hand, maybe you're here today, you know, man, I want to encourage you. Just have the boldness and the courage right now in this moment. Say, God, I'm stepping out. I'm coming back. I want to get my life right with you. Thank you. Thank you. You can put your hands down. I want to pray a prayer over you right now. If you raised your hand, and if you raised your hand, I want you to believe every word of this prayer that I've prayed. We know that God is going to do something amazing in your heart, in your life today. Father God, I thank you for every hand that's been raised, God. And Lord, every hand that's raised, Lord, we believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died on the cross for our sins and has forgiven each and every single one of us of our sins this morning. And we believe that there is salvation in no other name but the name of Jesus. And so we declare that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of our lives. We believe that not only did Jesus die, but he rose again from the dead and he is seated at the right hand of God. And that today I surrender my life to you, Jesus. I turn my back on my old way of living and I follow you. And I thank you for giving me of all my sins and giving me a brand new future and a new life. I ask you to be Lord of my life and the Savior of my soul. In Jesus' mighty name, Father, I thank you for every hand that's been raised. I thank you that the decision that they've made to follow you would be sealed in their heart. And Lord, that they would experience your salvation, experience your love, your unconditional love. I thank you that you seal this decision by the power of your Holy Spirit right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give those people a great hand. If you